Ensuring food safety is critical for all beef slaughter and processing operations. Food safety control and process management is necessary for beef processors to reduce the risk of foodborne illness from their products. According to the CDC, about 45 million people in the United States, or one in every six people, experience a foodborne illness each year. As a result, the United States Department of Agriculture Food Safety and Inspection Service has established regulations for the reduction of the risk of foodborne illness from bacteria and other agents associated with beef. Bacteria such as E.coli, 0157H7, and six additional shigatoxin-producing E.coli, commonly referred to as non-0157STEC, are a focus of the USDA regulations. In addition, the concern for these bacteria has also prompted beef slaughter and processing operations to consider food safety a high priority for their business. Every beef slaughter establishment is required to test for Escherichia coli, biotype 1, also known as generic E. coli. Generic E. coli is common in the intestinal tract and on the hides of all beef cattle, so it can be used as a process control indicator for carcass fecal contamination. Therefore, testing for generic E. coli is used to verify the effectiveness of an establishment's sanitation and food safety practices for beef slaughter. The objective of this video is to discuss standard procedures for the testing of beef carcasses for Escherichia coli biotype 1. Before conducting the sampling procedure, a carcass must be selected from the slaughter lot. The carcass should be randomly selected by using a random number generator such as a spreadsheet, a random number table, a web-based random number generator, or any other methods that produce random numbers. To be eligible for sampling, the carcass must have been in the cooler for 12 hours or longer after slaughter. Establishment personnel will also need to sample at a time in the day that will allow for shipment of samples to the laboratory on the same day. Samples should be shipped to the laboratory the day of sampling and tested the day after. Sampling supplies. The person designated to collect the generic E. coli sample should dress properly and practice good sanitary procedures. This will minimize cross-contamination of the sample and will allow for successful sampling. Some basic hygienic practices to follow would be to first remove all jewelry, then proceed with putting on a hairnet, a clean frock, hard hat, and steel-toed boots. Make sure the outer garments are clean. Hand washing is critical, and you need to thoroughly scrub and wash your hands. It's recommended that scrubbing of the hands up to the mid-arm with soap and water should be done for about 20 seconds. A disposable hand towel should be used to dry your hands when finished. In order to sample effectively and in a timely manner, it is important to have all supplies on hand. Also, assistance from another employee will help with the sampling process. The materials that are necessary for sampling include a table, a step ladder or platform, and a sampling kit. The sample kit should include a sterile, non-latex, non-bactericidal sampling sponge inside a sterile bag, sterile gloves, 25 mL of pre-chilled sterile sampling solution or a buffer such as Butterfield's phosphate buffer or buffered peptone water, labeled sample bags, a 10 cm by 10 cm sterilized sampling template, and a pre-chilled shipping container. To pre-chill, open the shipping container and place in a refrigerator or a cooler the day before sampling. All items should be available and assembled before you begin sampling. Preparation for sampling. To begin, a sample bag should be pre-labeled with a correlating carcass number, carcass side, date, and time of sample collection before the sample is taken. This information should also be recorded on records maintained by the slaughter establishment. To minimize cross-contamination during sampling, sample the areas on the carcass in the order of least to most heavy contaminated. The person conducting the sample should locate the sampling areas before beginning the procedures and plan to sample the flank, then the brisket, and finishing up with sampling the rump area of the carcass. The first step in the sampling procedure is to open the bag containing the sterile sponge. This is done by holding the bag by the wire closure and then tearing off the clear perforated strip at the top of the bag. To allow the bag to remain sterile, avoid touching the inside of the bag. Aseptic procedures must be followed for opening the bag by pulling on the tabs that are located on either side of the top of the bag. Some suppliers provide sterile dry sponges in bags. Other suppliers provide sterile sponges in the bag that have been hydrated with buffer. If starting out with a dry, sterile sponge, sampling buffer must be added to hydrate it prior to sampling. If the sponge is pre-hydrated, then you can skip this next step. To hydrate the sponge, remove the cap from the sterile 25 mL buffer solution, being careful not to touch the opening or contaminate the lid. Pour approximately 10 mL of the solution into the sponge bag and massage the outside of the bag until the sponge is fully hydrated. Then close the bag until the sampling process begins. Again, avoid touching the inside of the bag. The person conducting the sampling will need to wear sterile gloves and follow aseptic procedures to avoid cross-contamination of the sample. In addition, it's important not to contaminate the sterile gloves, the sampling template, or the sponge by touching any non-sterile items or surfaces. Therefore, sterile gloves must be put on in a manner that doesn't contaminate the outside of the glove before touching the sponge. An assistant can help by opening the glove bag and unfolding the wrapper containing the two gloves. The person sampling can put on the right glove, making sure to only touch the cuffed area of the glove, then move to the left glove, making sure not to touch the cuffed area with the sterile right glove. Next, the person conducting the sample will need to obtain the sampling template. The person assisting can tear the top off the template bag and work the template towards the top of the bag without touching the opening or the template. Then the person conducting the sampling should carefully remove the template, being sure not to touch the outside of the bag with the sterile gloves. Next, the person conducting the sampling will remove the sterile sponge from the bag. The assistant can work the sponge to the top of the bag. With the sterile gloves on, the person conducting the sampling should remove the hydrated sponge from the bag with the thumb, index, and middle fingers of the sampling hand. Carefully remove the sponge, making sure not to touch the outside of the bag with the sponge or the gloves. Sampling flag. The person sampling the carcass should now walk over to the carcass and locate the first sampling area, which is the flank area. The flank sampling area can be located by following the exterior flank muscle downwards to a point that is approximately 3 inches from the midline cut. The sampling area extends 10 centimeters posteriorly or up from this point and 10 centimeters laterally or away from the midline to form a 100 square centimeter sampling area. Place the template over the sampling area, being careful not to contaminate the template or the sampling area. Make sure the template is held securely on the carcass so it doesn't fall or become contaminated while sampling. To collect a sample, wipe the sponge over the enclosed sampling area 10 times horizontally and 10 times vertically using a moderate amount of pressure. The pressure used should be equivalent to the amount of pressure needed to remove dried blood from the carcass. Sampling brisket. The sampling procedure used on the flank will be repeated on the brisket. First, locate the brisket sampling area by drawing an imaginary line between the elbow straight across or medially to the midline cut. This will be the starting point for sampling. The sampling area will extend 10 centimeters along the imaginary line and 10 centimeters up from the midline cut, creating a 100 square centimeter area. Place the template over the determined sampling area. Using the same side of the sponge as used on the flank, wipe the sampling area 10 times horizontally and 10 times vertically, making sure the sponge and template do not touch any other surfaces. Sampling rump. The final sampling area, which is the rump area of the carcasses, will require a ladder or platform to reach. Walk up to the step ladder or platform, being careful not to touch the ladder with the gloves or hands or letting the sponge or template come into contact with any other surface. Locate the rump sampling area by drawing an imaginary line between the posterior aspect of the H-bone and the Achilles tendon. The sampling area begins where this line intersects the cut surface of the round and extends 10 centimeters posteriorly, or up, and 10 centimeters over to form a 100 square centimeter area. repeat the same sampling procedure for the rump as used with the flank and brisket. Make sure to use the opposite side of the sponge. After sampling the rump side, avoid contact with any surfaces when carefully descending the ladder or when walking back to the supply table. Preparation of the sample for shipping. Carefully place the sponge in the corresponding labeled sample bag, making sure the sponge does not touch the top or outside of the bag. The assistant can then add the remaining 15 mL of the sampling solution to the sample bag, being careful not to touch or contaminate the opening of the bottle. Massage the sponge by pressing on the outside of the bag to thoroughly mix the added sampling buffer. Remove excess air from the bag. Then fold down the top of the bag 3 to 4 times. Fold the wire tie back against the bag to tightly secure the bag. Allowing pre-chill time will cool down the temperature inside the shipping container, resulting in a shipping temperature that's comparable to the carcass environment. Refrigeration allows for the viability of the bacteria in the sample while inhibiting bacterial growth. A layering of materials should be used to pack the sample for shipment. First, place an ice pack at the bottom of the container. On top of the ice pack, place a layer of paper towels to insulate the sample from the frozen temperature of the ice pack. After double checking that the sample is securely closed, lay the sample on top of the paper towels. Over the secured sample, place another layer of paper towels to provide a barrier between the sample and the final ice pack. The final layer, an ice pack, should be placed on top of the last layer of paper towels, making sure that the container is packed tightly so the contents don't move during shipment. Seal the container and place the container for storage in a refrigerated environment until shipping occurs. Packaged samples should be shipped on the same day the sample is collected and delivered overnight to the selected laboratory for next day testing. The laboratory will need to use approved methods for enumerating Escherichia coli biotype 1. Results and charting. After completion of the testing, laboratories will provide a laboratory analysis sheet for each sample. This can be received through electronic methods, such as email or web access of your account. When results are received from the lab, the results will need to be matched with the sample information recorded at the establishment. Double-checking information is important, as mistakes can happen in the lab or in the labeling of the samples sent to the laboratory. If sample identification information is correct, then the results need to be recorded by a responsible person at the establishment. In addition to recording the results in a summary table, a statistical process control chart should be completed to ensure that the process is in control. The laboratory results report and the statistical process control chart need to be kept as records for the establishment. For plants that process less than 6,000 head a year, the monitoring program should consist of collecting at least one sample every week of operation, starting the first full week of operation after June 1st of each year until June 1st of the following year or until 13 samples have been collected. Plants that slaughter more than 6,000 head a year must randomly sample one out of every 300 carcasses. The statistical process control chart should then be used to determine if additional actions need to be taken. In this example control chart, corrective actions must be taken if any of the 13 samples within a sampling year are greater than an upper control limit of 3.1 CFU per centimeter square. In addition, corrective actions must also be taken if 3 of the 13 samples have values between the lower control limit of less than 0.08 CFU per centimeter square and the upper control limit of 3.1 CFU per centimeter square. If corrective actions are needed, the plant should review controls for fecal contamination during the slaughter process. Plant personnel should review dressing procedures and evaluate the source of fecal or ingested contamination that may occur during the slaughter process. Also, plant personnel should review the trimming procedures for removal of fecal and ingested material and effectiveness of the antimicrobial interventions used during the slaughter process. These procedures need to be repeated for each sample that is taken. For each sample, a new sampling kit and sampling materials need to be used. This video has provided detailed procedures for the collection of beef carcass samples for the enumeration of Escherichia coli biotype 1. The main points are that beef slaughter operations are required by USDA to conduct verification process control testing for Escherichia coli biotype 1. Employees must know and understand proper procedures for the collection of samples. Beef processors must keep records and must take corrective actions when monitoring for generic E. coli indicates a potential problem.